I'll call this meeting of Fitchburg Town Council to order. We're going to, as we normally do, take a moment of reflection, and I would like for us to think about Megan Dorsett, who passed away a couple of weeks ago, who was such a vital member of our community. She was a planner. She wrote the comprehensive plan for Montgomery County several years ago. She passed away at the age of 60, so hope you'll remember Megan and her family in your thoughts. Thank you. Thank you. We could rise from the Pledge of Allegiance to the flag. I'm going to ask Councilman Henry Showalter if he would lead.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Are there any adjustments to the agenda? Hearing none, we will move on to public hearings. We have three public hearings to discuss tonight. The first is a rezoning request by John Elmore, agent for Donald and Rachel Wood, for an approximately 1.15 acre portion of tax map number 435-A20, located at 840 Peppers Ferry Road Northwest, from A Agriculture to B3 General Business. The property was designated as residential in the future land use map in 2013 Christiansburg Comprehensive Plan. Is there anyone here to address this? Thanks, John. Name and address, please. I know it's John Elmore.
Yes, I'm John Elmore. I appreciate this opportunity to appear as agent for Don and Rachel Wood. Don's here with me tonight, and my wife Juanita is here with me. And we have agreed to purchase this property if the town council does agree to allow it to be rezoned. There's some good and needy reasons that we would like to get this property rezoned. For one thing, my wife and I need to have the property for future expansion of our mini storage business that's there near New River Valley Mall. And that's also where several new apartments are going up and some single family houses are going up at this time. And our mini storage is almost full right now. We do need to expand it, so we would like to have the opportunity to do that. Also, Don and Rachel Wood need to sell the property and use the proceeds from the sale to do some repair work to their house, which includes a new roof. Also, the only access to this property is through our property, or Don's and Rachel's property. And it presently joins our property. Currently, this property is not being farmed either, so it really wouldn't cut back on in farming. And as far as the town's concerned, it would mean a greater tax revenue for the town. So that's our reason.
Thank you. Any questions? And John, well, let's set down your property. Most of your storage buildings sits in the back of your house and down. Is that the same general area?
It is.
Uh-huh. Okay, so it's not that it makes a difference whether it's visible from the highway or not, but I mean, it's not something that's going to be built right on Peppers Ferry Road.
Right. It's not right on Peppers Ferry Road. It's down, down, like you said, and it's on the west side of our property.
Okay. Thanks. Anyone else to address this? Any comments or questions? Thank you. Normally what happens is we may vote on this in 2 weeks, which is what we normally do on public hearings. We give them a chance to come out and hear anything, any items. Have they been to planning commission?
Yeah, it's unanimous. I was looking at it, and I was going to recommend at the end of this that we add this to tonight's agenda for action.
And the same here. Yeah, great thing.
I'm holding my tongue, but yeah, it's just.
So let me get out of public meetings, and then we'll make another adjustment. How's that? Thank you. The second is an ordinance amendment to Chapter 42 zoning of the Town of Christiansburg Town Code to allow for research, experimental, or testing laboratories, including animals, in the I-2 General Industrial District with a conditional use permit. Is anyone here to address this issue? Mr. Wingfield, are you familiar with it?
I am. I believe it was originally put in the code, from my understanding, to prohibit things like testing on animals for things like cosmetics. Is, I believe, the original intent behind it. There it has been potential for a animal testing facility where the animals used in research, their actual parts would be genetically modified so that they could be used as human transplant. And there is a possibility of something like that going in the industrial park. I think the town potentially should be open to consider it. I understand the reason it was put in there is kind of, I think, more of an ethical, like I say, you didn't want necessarily testing cosmetics on animals here in town. But if there is a, I guess personally, I think if there is a legitimate life-saving use for animal testing, I think it should be, I guess, worth consideration.
I think in our discussion, you said that these are genetically engineered.
This code change would affect all the I-2 districts, so okay. It would affect all the I-2 zoning. But it would allow a facility in I-2. Like I say, we did, I guess, have somebody potentially interested in the Falling Branch Corporate Park, but it would affect all I-2 zoning. Okay.
Let me ask you, you said potentially, but you do not have a company at this time.
Well, Montgomery County's spoken to a company, although, you know, just a prospect is just that. You know, they get prospects all the time. So no guarantee of someone coming. And they do, the county wants to change regardless because of the potential for somebody else either coming on either this potential prospect or a future prospect.
Okay.
So they want to scare somebody away by the code the way
it is. By simply just saying it's prohibited right now.
Okay.
Say again? Has it been in planning yet?
Yes, unanimous on that as well.
Full. Okay. And then contingent. Anyone else here to discuss this matter?
Chris Wallace, 1370 Rib Street. I spoke with the director of the Montgomery County Department of Economic Development and was informed by him that they are acting as an agent for a company. It's not just a prospect. They are acting that this whole process, this and the next thing on there, the conditional use permit, is them acting as an agent for a company. Not that it's a prospect, they're acting as an agent to get this stuff taken care of for the company. He refused to say the name of the company. I mean, I think I have an idea of who it is from the information we just got. But you know, I'm not going to say who it is, and I don't reckon y'all are either. He said y'all. He also said that the town was aware of the name of the corporation. But you know, this is not open.
Well, it's a closely held secret, Chris, because I don't know who they are. No.
I haven't heard either.
But this is not open and transparent government, having the Montgomery County Department of Economic Development run interference for a corporation so that the corporation doesn't have to come out publicly and have what they do looked at. And if it is the company that, you know, from the research I've done on it, they also are doing vaccine research funded by the DOD for things like anthrax, H1N1. Pretty dangerous stuff. And if the DOD is involved, I can pretty much guarantee you that they're testing vaccines for the weaponized versions of these things. I think there should be a little more transparency.
Thank you. Thank you. Any other comments or questions? Mr. Hamilton.
Hello, Brian Hamilton, Montgomery County Economic Development, EDA Secretary Director. So the Economic Development Authority asked for this code amendment for research and testing on animals. It's a fairly standard practice in Virginia. I think the Planning Commission determined that. And the FDA, all vaccine trials go through an animal testing process. So if we were to get a biotech company, for example, that wanted to locate in the park, this would hold them back from being able to move forward. Thank you.
Can I ask one question? You said it's pretty common. Most localities throughout the state do not have this in their code. Is that what you're saying?
No, what I'm saying is it's really not differentiated, and maybe Andrew can add more. There's a mousery in the Virginia Tech Corporate Research Center for testing drugs on mice. So it already is occurring in our region, I guess the best way I can say. Any other questions?
Yeah, one last question. Where I work at the CRC, one company in there is Revivicor. You know Revivicor?
Mm-hmm.
Is it similar to what they would be doing? Because that's going on in the county right now down in Elk Valley. They have a pig farm down there.
They have a facility in the county.
Is that similar or is it different?
I can't really speak to that.
Right. But it is already going on in the county right now.
I cannot say for this code change that's going on.
Oh, I see.
Revivicor is working in the CRC and they have their own farm down in Catawba. But I can't discuss whether or not we're working with them.
I understand. No, my point was, is there already a similar type activity going on in the county?
Yes.
Yeah, and that was my point. I use a specific example, but it's just because it's one I'm familiar with. Okay, thank you, Brian.
Anyone else? Alrighty. Contingent on the above ordinance amendment, conditional use permit request by the Economic Development Authority of Montgomery County for tax map parcel 599-1-7. 3.69 acres to allow for research, experimental, and testing laboratories, including animals in the I-2 General Industrial District. The conditional use permit, the property is designated as industrial in the future land use map, 2013 Christiansburg Comprehensive Plan. Anybody to address it?
The Economic Development Authority is requesting a conditional use permit for animal testing. We have had a company that has looked at the site and has expressed interest, and we do not want to hinder further potential developments with this company in the future. Since it was not allowed in code, that caused some nervousness on the company's behalf. So we're just going ahead and would like to recommend to get a CUP on this property.
And this is in the Falling Branch.
Falling Branch Corporate Park, Lot 7.
Thank you. I think that we're probably going to allow ourselves a couple of weeks to review all this. I know it's been before planning, but I think we're gonna sit on this one for 2 weeks and come back and have a final vote at our meeting on the 27th.
Thank you, sir.
You can't do a code in one night anyway.
No,
you have to wait.
No, we have to. So anyway. All right. That is all of our public hearings. Do I hear a motion to move?
Mayor, I make a motion to act on item 3A this evening, a request by the Elmores for rezoning to business from residential or from agricultural.
And I'll second that.
Got a motion to second. Any discussions? Then we are going to move that to discussion and action by mayor and council. That is section B. That is section 8. And that will be item A. Madam Clerk.
Yes, sir. Councilman Bishop?
Aye.
Councilman Collins?
Aye.
Councilman Hubbard?
Aye.
Councilman Carlton?
Aye.
Councilman Stipes?
Aye.
That is 5-0 and one absent. Thank you very much. We have a consent agenda consisting of the council minutes of January 23rd, 2018 and January 30th, 2018 and the Cambria North Franklin Street contract amendment for right-of-way acquisition services.
Make a motion to approve the consent agenda as presented and as was in our agenda packet.
Second.
The motion is second. Any discussion? Hearing none. Madam Clerk.
Yes, sir. Councilman Bishop?
Aye.
Councilman Collins?
Aye.
Councilman Hubbard?
Aye.
Councilman Showalter?
Aye.
Councilman Stipes?
Aye.
Very good. That is 5-0 and 1. Thank you very much. The next is our citizens' comments section, where we invite citizens to come forward and address council on items or issues that you may have concerns with, suggestions you would like to make. As always, we ask that you come to the microphone, give your name and address, and we're going to limit your comments tonight to 3 minutes. Anyone here to address council? Hearing none, I'll close the citizens' comments. In our introductions and presentations, town council and Christiansburg High School Partnership, are they here tonight?
Yes, sir, they are. I'm pleased to say that they're here tonight. Yeah, would you folks please rise and introduce yourself, please? Just give us a little history, you know, of yourself, what your future plans are.
My name is Nicole Dioia. I'm co-president of the Student Government Association at Christiansburg High School. I'm a senior. Plan on graduating Christiansburg High School and attending a four-year university, probably in Virginia.
I'm Brooke Serpens. I'm secretary of SGA, and I plan on graduating and then hopefully going to Tech in the fall.
My name is Jasmine. I'm a junior. I'm a reporter for SGA. I plan on going to a four-year college. My dream school is UVA, so hopefully I get in.
No, that's great. It's great to have you all here. You don't know how great it's to be here. Are you folks have any kind of news from school to talk about or to tell us about?
Well, you had asked me at the...
You're not supposed to say that. I'm just teasing you.
Your favorite set up.
Well, wrestling has their state competition this weekend, and that's the end of the wrestling.
This weekend?
Yes. It's wrestling states.
Okay. Okay. I need a favor.
I believe it's in Salem, isn't it?
Oh, Portsmouth.
Portsmouth? Okay.
Okay. I need to get a hold of the people who's in charge of the club, or what do y'all call the wrestling club, or?
Like the team?
No. The folks
oh,
that...
Oh, the
The Booster Club? Yeah, do y'all have that for the wrestling team?
I'll find that out.
Okay, good, good. Because we want to have some kind of a celebration when they come back from there with the 17th state title. You know. Okay, that'd be great if you could get that for me. I appreciate that. And I need y'all to get something planned and stuff too. Okay, so be thinking, you know, what you would like to do. Okay?
Sure.
You got any more news?
Yeah.
Oh, the
girls and boys won region for track, indoor track.
Oh, super.
Who's this?
Indoor track. Girls
Very good.
We both won.
Very good.
So their state is this weekend coming up as well, right?
It's the 23rd.
Okay. Aquatics, I know, is this weekend. BHSL.
Good.
Christiansburg Conference.
So anything new going on at the high school? How about the construction? Are they working on the baseball fields and... I know they're not going to start the football field until March, but are you seeing any dirt being moved around?
Not yet. They took down some trees in between the tennis courts and the football field, but that's pretty much all they've done. So.
Okay.
Great.
Randy, while we have them here, do we have everything ironed out with the Huckleberry Trail coming through the high school property?
Y'all can be seated.
We don't have the easement yet, although we have a location for the easement, and I think everything is pretty much ironed out.
So so they don't need, we don't need to stick them on Mr. Dagler and
I still think they can. You guys know that? We're connecting the Huckleberry to the high school property.
Yeah, I think we've heard about that a little
bit. You need to apply some pressure to your administration.
And yeah, really.
Tell them to sign it. Tell them to sign it.
But I didn't say that, Mr. Collins did.
Mr. Showalter is going to be helping with this project too. Okay. Do you have any words of advice for us, please? We need it.
It's a pleasure to have you out here. What do y'all think about having a student government day where students from the high school run to town for a day?
That's an amazing idea.
Can you start right now? Come on up.
So why don't you have your people contact Mr. Collins and Mr. Wingfield, and we'll see what we can put together. I think it's good that you do have a day. And not only, you say the government, not only the town council and the administration, but to ride with the police, fire, rescue, to participate in all of it, so you see what's coming on. So y'all work that out and tell us when you want to do it and how we can do it.
If you'll tell Mr. Robbins and the principal, Henry Showalter, and I will be up. Well, first I'm going to get a form to see y'all at the plan. This week a good week for you?
Yeah.
Okay.
Anytime good. You want to.
Okay. All and we'll right. plan the parade for the wrestling stuff too while we're there.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you all for being here.
Are you coming back? Are you coming back?
We have people coming every.
Thank you.
Right. Sounds good. We have an annual report tonight from New York Community Action. Terry? And that's not John. I know that's not John.
Terry Wilson.
Terry Wilson. Okay.
Yes, I'm not John. I'm Tanya Nguyen, and I am the local government appointment on the board for Community Action. And we basically wanted to come tonight just to share our annual report, but to also just thank you all for supporting our agency and the things that we can do in our community. And I'm going to just touch just a little bit, touch on just a little bit of what we do in the town of Christiansburg. One of our facilities that's on Roanoke Street, we operate some programs out of that. We have served 3,736 clients in Montgomery County for this annual reporting period. We have an emergency assistance program which helps families who are experiencing financial issues. We'll help with utilities, rent, medication, transportation, things of that nature. And we have a Virginia Cares program which we work with folks that are transitioning successfully from jail back into their community. We want to help them financially with in some training areas, whereas it's job readiness, employment search, life skills, and support groups. And we also have another program called To Our House, which we work with the homeless men in the community. And we work with local churches, and we basically house them during the winter months from November to March. And we, the churches are wonderful to work with. They will let the men stay in their, usually in their fellowship halls. And the volunteers from the church will provide meals for them, dinner, just basic needs for them. And we also have our Head Start program, which is here in the town. And we currently have 57 children that we are serving. So trying to get them ready for school, that's basically ages 3 through 5. We also have a special partnership with McKeep, which is basically staffed by volunteers. I know you guys are familiar with that. But we serve a lot of families who qualify for, basically it's for clothing and household materials. So, anything else on
this?
I'd like
that. Yeah, that's pretty good. Yeah. Also, on one of your pages, our newest program, Swift Start, is a program that we're doing with TAC, the Community Action Agency in Roanoke. I think that's probably near the back of your annual report. That's a job training program, and we're providing childcare as well for that program. And we call that a two-gen program because we're working with children as well as with your parents. I wanted to, first of all, I want to apologize. Tanya mentioned the 3,736 clients we're serving in Montgomery County. I wish our database would allow us to dig in and tell you exactly how many of those folks are within the town of Christiansburg limits, but unfortunately our database won't allow us to do that. But I do want to also talk with you a little bit about the funds that the town of Christiansburg particularly gives to New River Community Action that we restrict to our housing and homeless programs. And those programs are described for you on page 11 of the annual report. Rapid rehousing is one of those programs, and that serves our most vulnerable clients, those who are literally homeless. And that doesn't mean doubled up. That means either on the street or living in a place not suitable for human habitation or living in an emergency shelter. We also have the Homeless Prevention Program, which helps us serve folks that are in imminent danger of homelessness through eviction. So with both rapid rehousing and with our homeless prevention programs, we can provide temporary financial assistance, but we also provide housing counseling and renter ed workshops for those folks, help them try to develop a path back toward housing stability. We can also offer our renter ed workshops and our housing counseling programs to individuals who are not homeless or in imminent danger of becoming homeless. Lots of times we couple this with the emergency assistance program that Tanya mentioned a minute ago. Sometimes folks need some help in understanding their rights as tenants, but then also we have a lot of landlords come to these workshops because landlords need to understand their rights as landlords as well. And so between the renter education and the housing counseling, that helps us work with folks who need some assistance in understanding what might be suitable housing for them, where they might get that, what might be suitable budget guidelines that they need to think about in terms of their own budgets, as well as relationships with landlords. So your particular funds that you give us every year, we restrict just to the housing and homeless programs. I wanted to give you a little bit more information on this. Are there any questions of us?
The comment, the thing here, the rapid rehousing.
Correct.
That could be domestic problems within a family. Would you handle that part?
So, as you all might know, New River Community Action has a rich history of program development. And one of the programs that we developed and spun off back in the late 70s, early 80s, before my time, but I know that it was that's part of our rich history, was the Women's Resource Center. So the Women's Resource Center has an emergency shelter as well as transitional housing. And rapid rehousing money can be used to help those clients gain permanent housing. So in answer to your question, yes. However, we don't administer that portion of the rapid rehousing money that comes to the New River Valley. The WRC administers that particular portion. Our rapid rehousing money helps individuals that walk in off the street, the men who are housed at To Our House, and the families that are housed at New River Family Shelter all access our rapid rehousing funds.
Thank you.
Well, you all have been around a long time, and we appreciate all that you do. I know that this is one of the things that I believe is quite easy for us to fund every year, and we do like to see that our money is well used, as it always has been. Guys, any other questions, comments?
I mean, I think we appreciate you coming here every year. When you come and show us some stuff, and it sort of gives us an uplift and reminds us of the good stuff that you guys do.
Thank you.
Yeah, you folks are going to be applauded a lot. Y'all do great work, and we appreciate it very much.
Thank you.
Very much. Possibly we could get the school, you know, involved with something like this, too. That'd be something good for you and us and them.
Okay.
Very good.
Thank you. We appreciate your support.
You continue to have it, I think. I call the hunch.
Yeah.
We got a definite maybe.
Call the hunch. That's what I thought.
Next, we have Ben Robson. We're going on a big event 2018. Ben, the podium is yours.
Council, residents of Christiansburg. I'm Ben Robson. I'm a student at Virginia Tech from Gainesville, Virginia, up by DC, studying industrial and systems engineering. And I'm here to talk to everyone about the big event at Virginia Tech. So you might ask, what is the big event? The big event is the second largest event of its kind in the nation, Texas A&M is the biggest, or the second largest in terms of volunteer participation. Every spring, thousands of students, faculty, and staff come together to complete hundreds of community service projects throughout Blacksburg, Christiansburg, and the entire New River Valley. Projects are completed regardless of need or socioeconomic status and free of charge. Instead, it is the big event's goal to simply say thank you for the entire community surrounding Virginia Tech, as our event is seated in the university's motto, "That I may serve, in person." So the big event, one big day, one big thanks. So last year, we had 8,223 volunteers complete 1,174 projects. Our goals for 2018 include 10,000 volunteers and 1,300 projects to serve the community. So our team, we have two directors and one assistant director. We have 25 executive team members. I'm one of those 25. I'm one of the co-directors of project evaluations. And then to help us put on such a large event, we have around 140 staff, including 58 committee and 82 operations staff. So we like to share our resident bio when we come talk to people. This is one that we received from a homeowner saying that this is a terrific program. It is great to see the enthusiasm and good humor and willingness to work hard. I think there must be times when there is some friction between tech and townspeople, and this is a program that goes a long ways toward mitigating the situation. Great work and congratulations. We receive comments like this from the people we serve all the time, and we love to hear it. So how can you get involved? Anybody can request a project. We invite you to go to vtbigevent.org/residents and fill out the form on there, the job request form, or you may call us at 540-440-1244. And if you'd like to volunteer, you can go to the same website, vtbigevent.org/volunteer. If you'd like to connect with us, our website is vtbigevent.org. We're on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram, as well as LinkedIn at vtbigevent. And we share photos, videos, all kinds of stuff to keep everyone updated. And with that, I'll be happy to answer any questions, or you can contact communications at vtbigevent.org.
What's the date of that again, the 18th?
April 7th, 2018.
Well, I'd just like to say this. I'm a graduate of Virginia Tech, and when I see stuff like this, it really makes me proud to be a Hokie, and especially when I hear that you're doing second best in the whole country. I mean, a tremendous project like this too, and I know that Real Life for Life, and I think most people are familiar with this, is a cancer, raising money for cancer, and Tech almost every year raises more money than anybody else in the country. I think last year they raised $450,000. And I just wish you pass it on here that the Christiansburg Town Council really appreciates what you guys do here and appreciate what Tech is about. And there's more than just beating UVA in basketball.
Yeah, we like things they do every year.
Yeah. Is the volunteer, is that strictly for Tech students? Or?
Typically it's mostly Tech students, but we do have some community members who choose to volunteer. I believe we can make it happen.
I think last year, so there were several parents that came down, maybe one of the choral groups that was having a concert, and they came down and worked that morning, and then the kids had their concert that night. I met a couple of them. I usually try to get out and about and see what they're up to in town.
Well, this is such a great event, like the Renew the New. Hopefully everybody's familiar with that, but I'm checking because, you know, Christiansburg is participating in the ACE program with the local community college, which requires volunteers. And it would be interesting because you could get a whole day of volunteer hours in, even if you're a New River student or let's say a Radford student wants to do it. But more importantly, if you're at New River and you need an extra 8 hours in the spring to earn that volunteer, because you have to volunteer for 40 hours in order to get that free education, of course, keep up with the GPA. But it'd be great for somebody wanting to get those extra hours but attending New River with probably the intention of attending Tech in a few years to be able to sign up and get those extra 8 hours in. That's why I'm just asking.
Okay. About. We can start that in the fall, is that correct?
Yeah, it's going to start in the fall. So Christopher High School has already done their, they already had an event where students could go down and all apply for it. So,
very good. We have Melissa Thimmett and Anika, and I have a phone conference Friday morning with your co-directors to see what else we can do as a town to help. So we're aware of it.
Well, we thank you for your support.
Thanks, man.
Thank you.
Terry Caldwell, Director of Aquatics, to present Christopher Aquatic Center 2017 in review.
Thank you, Mayor, Council. Great to be here tonight to talk about our Aquatic Center in our beautiful town of Christiansburg. I'm wondering if we could just hit one of the little lights. I'd like for you to see these great pictures of our Aquatic Center and the PowerPoint. Before I begin, I'd like to recognize Amelia Tuckwiller from our advisory board. She's with us tonight.
Welcome.
Started. I'd like to begin with our community commitment from the Aquatic Center and run some of this information by you again to remind us. The Christiansburg High School sends over community-based instruction students every day to the Aquatic Center. They bus them over and send someone along to supervise them, and they do various activities. Like you can see the young lady on the left, she's helping us clean the windows, and they learn how to mop, and they learn how to dust and things like that, and it gives them a good opportunity to see what it's like to hold an actual job at the Aquatic Center. We also have two Christiansburg High School interns, and we have one intern from Radford University. We are still currently involved with the Montgomery County Prevention Partners Program, and if you remember, we do the Super Splash. That is where it's free entry to the Aquatic Center if you bring a can of soup and donate it, and then we obviously take all of the soup to McKee. So that works out wonderful. Our PTA events are very popular in the evening. If anyone has young children, you know that the leisure pool fills up real fast after hours for the PTA events. Usually about 300 children from our Montgomery County Elementary Schools. We continue to receive requests for donations to organizations, and of course we require that on letterhead, and then we give out maybe a free membership or daily passes, and they can raffle them off, or a lot of times they're silent auction at organizations. We hold the coat drive, this year we collected 33 coats, and we donated those to the Montgomery County Christmas store. And of course, we're part of the Santa and the Blue Elves toy drive with our police department. And we also include a free pass to all new residents in our town, and that is given out by our treasurer's department when they sign up for water at the town of Christiansburg. So that works out real nice. Mm-hmm. And next, the Special Olympics are at the Aquatic Center. They were there last fall, and they'll be here this spring again. There's 67 athletes. They come in on Wednesday evenings and enjoy the leisure pool, the therapy pool, and they brave a couple lanes in the competitor pool, which is obviously pretty cool. So it's very nice to have them with us. Our adult learn to swim program, if you'll remember about 2 years ago, Crystal Jones applied for a grant for you from U.S. Swimming, and she received that grant and has since kept applying for it, and we received it, the 34 participants that she had this last year, which really added up to 217 individual swim lessons. Other water fitness classes, as you can see on the bottom, we had 608 participants this past year, and swim lessons, 521. And the Relay for Life, we can thank Councilman Huppert for that. This is his idea, and he held it last year for the first time. And he's a diehard. He stayed at the facility for the entire time, the 9 a.m. to 7, and clocked people as they were swimming and water walking, and they clocked 16 miles and raised over $500. And he tells me this year that he's marked way up above the $500 commitment for the American Cancer Society.
You know, as politicians, we always got a lot of talking. You know, it's a deal. You can walk, go in there and walk or swim for as little as time or as much of time as you want and donate some money. And I hope to do it again this year. We're doing the 16th of March this year, so for Friday. And it's for fun. It's water's warm and it's shallow, and it's, and the benefits are great.
Thank you. Okay, in the Montgomery County Public Schools second grade swim lessons. Boy, isn't that something else. We partnered with Montgomery County Public Schools with the help and partnership of Blacksburg Lions Club and, of course, our New River Health Foundation. Over 700 children last year that we were able to teach swim lessons to. And I wanted to add at that point also that McCarg Elementary from Radford City brings 100 kids over for swim lessons in another contract. So it's pretty interesting to see how that is growing and appreciate the support that we get from those organizations. Our spring break camp had 16 children. Of course, that is when the schools are closed for spring break and they sign up and they come out to the aquatic center. And depending on the weather, we do different activities. There you can see them at Depot Park. They get to dye Easter eggs, a bunch of arts and crafts. They all just have such a great time when they're at the aquatic center. And of course, the swimming's a portion of our camps. Our summer camp last year, 570 children. 45% of those were residents of our town. 25% of all participants also enrolled in our swim lessons. So that's private enrollment besides the camp. So how neat is it for parents that you drop your child off at the aquatic center for the day and they can also get swim lessons? You don't have to drive back at night. We're going to increase our summer camp fees a little bit this year. Residents by $5 and I want to say maybe $15 for non. But you can see it goes to $85 and $105. And instead of 60 campers, we're going to accept 50 this year. Of course, we could potentially accept 150 because that program fills up within a day or two. The reason I'm reducing it a little bit is we struggle with the restrooms. The children go swimming and they need to change, and we have to close the public restrooms in order to let the children in there. So obviously my goal would be to have private restrooms for our campers. It's such a huge program in the summer, so
how many days
that's why we're reducing it a little bit. It's fairly chaotic with 60 children.
How many days is that camp? Is it all week? Is this a week-long camp?
All week, yeah. Mm-hmm. They can drop off at 7:30 and pick up at 5:30.
Monday through Friday,
yeah. There's a few weeks when we have huge swim meet rentals that we're not able to accommodate. But otherwise, we've adjusted, and then we've advertised that in advance so the families are well aware of how that works. Our Club CAC is our after-school program that we just started this fall. And we got out of the starting blocks a little bit late with that. So we only have about 8 students that we pick up at the elementary school and the primary school here in Christiansburg. We take the bus and we go pick them up or the van. And they come back and they stay at the Aquatic Center their afternoon with us, and the parents pick them up by 6 a.m. I'm projecting that this fall we're going to see an increase in that, that the word is out a little bit more. It's difficult for parents to kind of take that step away from what they're used to and branch off into something different. So I'm hoping that this would get up to closer to the 24 max that we can take, because that's what, you know, travels on a bus. So I'll keep you updated on how that program is running. Our birthday parties, Scott Popak is behind those, and they're still running really great with the mermaid and the pirate. And also, you can go ahead and just rent a room. $50 for 2 hours, and you can bring in whatever else that you would like to host your birthday party. So it gives an option. We held 225 birthday parties last year. Our after-hours rental has become huge. You can rent the leisure pool or the therapy pool at the Aquatic Center after hours, and 7 to 9 rental is $250 for less than 100 people. So those options are out there, and people are taking up on them. It's real nice to see how that works. We've had a few sports parties. That means teams from football teams or baseball teams, those types of things, come in and use the aquatic facility. Blue Fins is the name of our swim team. Our summer league has 60 participants, and we placed fourth in last summer's championship. And our homeschool, Fins Homeschool, averages about 12, and it consistently runs each month for their training and their lessons. And then the Evening Fins program is our year-round program. We've been trying to kind of get that going a little bit. It's neat for the community to be able to allow a child to kind of jump in and see if that's what they like a pre-recreation program to swimming. So it's nice to see. And that number changes, obviously, but it's pretty consistent each month. So one of our special events last year, I'm sure you all heard about, was the First Responders Battleship. Wow, is that something else? If you missed it, I'd have to say you missed it. It was canoes in the water, battling it out with all of our first responders from Virginia Tech, Blacksburg, Montgomery County, and here in Christiansburg. And they all had a great time. And the audience had a great time. So we will definitely be doing that again. It was a fundraiser event, and all of the money went to the winner. And the winner this year was the Montgomery County Sheriff's Office. So, you know, all of us Christiansburg fans, we were right there. So it's interesting to see how that all played out. We had fun. Pat the CAC, if you'll remember, Susan Bricken came and presented that to all of you all, and you gave her the support to fund that program. And you can see there, Frank Beamer came for the non-alcohol tailgate, and it was open and free to the public. There was food available, 65 swimmers, but 150 spectators for that. So we were real pleased to have the Pack the CAC program. So the competition pool and reveal. We hosted 37 events, which was 4 more than 2016. We held our first water polo tournament in Virginia Tech Club Polo. We held the largest swim meet since we've opened with over 1,300 athletes, and that was our H2 Okie Swim and Try Winter Invite. 2 state high school meets and 1 regional high school meet, 2 collegiate championship meets, over 11,000 athletes competed at the Aquatic Center. We started inner tube water polo, and we hosted the NCAA Zone A Diving, which is the preliminaries to NCAA championship. The tourism. I can't not have anything about tourism. As you can see, the table set up in the lobby there. That's a permanent fixture now at our Aquatic Center, and what a wonderful partnership and collaboration that we have with Lisa Bleakley for our tourists that come into the Aquatic Center. All of the maps, information is right there for folks, and then of course they're right behind us where we hold the swim meets. We do a lot of different things with tourism. I go to the tourism meetings and work directly with the directors of sales of the hotels, the goal there being to keep the lodging prices low. When we talk about, how are we getting these swim meets to stay in town and want to come to the Christiansburg. Those are the little things that are important to these swim meet organizations. You know, are we keeping our lodging prices low? Are we welcoming them? What kind of town do we have? What's our personality type? Are we welcome? You know, that's all of what that is. And I feel in the past 7 years, we have done a great job in hosting these meets. You know, you take Bill Beecher prior to Ian, and now Ian has that spot. They work long hours during these swim meets to be absolutely certain when the organization needs them, they're there. And we're not going, well, let me call him, I think he's at home. They're on site, they're able to answer those questions and take care of the meet organizations. Our Black Friday specials, I'd like to thank our advisory board for that because they're behind this every year and decide what they would like the special to be and push that. This year we sold 540 memberships in just those couple of days. Town residents, 273. I was very pleased with that number to see how it's growing for our town residents. And then our New Year's Eve splash. We held our second one last year, and as you can see, we had 202 total attendees. That attendance increased by 13%. 40% of the participants purchased their tickets in advance because they knew they wanted to come. And activities that we offered included the water bouncer, the paddle boards, floats, the diving boards were open, we had a sparkling toast of grape juice, and then of course the huge ball is dropped from the 10-meter tower. So that's also another fun event for families. By 9 o'clock, it's over at 9 o'clock. So their parents are home with the kids. And this year it happened to fall not on New Year's Eve, and I think that's why our attendance went up a little bit. So I think we're going to try to offer it the night before New Year's Eve so that parents can go out the next night. Kind of what we figured out maybe the key there. So where are we today? We don't have that snow outside right now, but we do have a total membership of 2,459. Of that, 837 are our residents. Our daily visitors are 27,425, and of that, 13,000 residents. Radford City daily uses, over 3,800. And Radford University members, 377. And our Christiansburg employee memberships, employee and family, 16, employee only, 32, and employee plus 110. That's a nice little chunk of town employees using our facility, so thank you very much for that. 2018, we're in a new year. I want to just kind of let you know of a few things coming up this year. We are partnering with the American Red Cross Aquatic Examiner Service. So what that means is some representatives from the American Red Cross are going to drop into our aquatic facility and give an objective third-party evaluation of our entire facility, how we operate, what our records look like, how our training processes are, and you know, how we are in place, emergency action plans, documentation system. They're going to do drills. They're going to also arrive when nobody even knows they're there. And they're going to kind of come back and provide the supervisors an opportunity for, do we have any improvements we need to make or any suggestions? We look forward to that. The Senior Olympics is May 4th, and of course that's hosted this year by our Christiansburg Parks and Recreation Center, and we're able to obviously hold the swimming portion of the Senior Olympics. The swim Relay for Life is Friday, March 16th from 8 a.m. until 4. Our community yard sale will be May 5th, and that is really growing too. I'm real pleased with that program. Tourism will I'll be down with Lisa in Landsburg on March 16th for the Blitz that she's doing down there. And of course, we just partnered together for the Hodgepodge radio segment. Water polo, we're holding a clinic and a Virginia Tech tournament, 200 to 400 athletes. And of course, all of our summer camps and youth camps will continue. Our battleship is September 28th, and then the New Year's Eve splash will be December 30th. Swim Meet 2018 snapshot. So we're hosting four high school regional meets in February, which is up free due to the rotation of high school meets. So if you're familiar with any of the high school swimming, all of that rotates. Okay, so even the high school championships and things like that, they're going to rotate to different facilities throughout the state. So that's why we don't have a high school meet this year, due to the rotation. The meets before April, one collegiate championship meet, which is the one that came into town today. I don't know if you all noticed some of the buses. That's the Colonial Athletic Association. And if you remember, that is a swim meet that we went into the contract five-year partnership with. And I would like to remind everyone who's in town these couple of days. College of Charleston, University of Delaware, Drexel University, Elon University, Hofstra University, James Madison, Northeastern, Towson, UNC Wilmington, and College of William and Mary. That's who we get to host in our town of Christiansburg for the next couple of days. We have three USA swimming age group meets, one Speedo sectional, one Virginia Tech dual meet with UVA, one Virginia Tech invitational, four regional high school meets, five high school meets, one collegiate water polo tournament, and then the water polo clinic. And a little bit dark in the, too dark there to read, but that's listing some of the meets and the visitors or the athletes that are coming to town, and you can see there's maybe quite a few numbers there that are reading 800, 900, 1,000 spectators. So what are we in? We're in swim meet season. So it's a difficult sometimes for our residents to be able to adjust for that. And a reminder to them that we do have days on the back of memberships, yearly memberships to accommodate that when you purchase a pass. So you really are not buying 365 days, you might be buying 390 days, depending on what the projection is for that year. It's already included. The interesting piece that I want to add with swim meets is everybody wants this time frame. All the swim meet organizations, they want about the middle of February to the first week of March. So why? So their athletes can qualify for the sectionals at the end of March. So in theory, there's a lot of competition trying to come into the aquatic center. When we decided to branch off and go into the contract, you know, we lost the independent high school league meet because why? They want only that swim meet that week. So do you see how we're only in that 4 week time frame in this sport where everybody wants in? So, you know, there's opportunities there to kind of rotate, and you'll see that in the swimming world. You see every year it changes because they're rotating to different pools and facilities, and I think we do a really great job here in our town showcasing what we have. We have, you know, we're between both universities. We have things for people to do when they come to town. And that's what these organizations are looking for. You know, what is the town of Christiansburg giving us? We love coming down there, go down the mountain, you know. So I'd like for you to think in those terms when we talk about swim meets and keeping them here, even though we've heard other aquatic facilities may come on, right? They know, they see what's going on here. So we've got some competition, you know, in the works and not right on top of us. Liberty University is open. I think you'll remember Bert Lachlan, who was on our advisory board when we first opened the Aquatic Center. He is actually the Associate Athletic Director at Liberty University. So we have talked one-on-one. The Lewisburg facility, they are calling for numbers, and they want to do a presentation on the 1st of March for a 50-meter. So there's different things in the works, you know, but I think it's a ways off, and I think that the sport is growing. So I feel that you're pretty comfortable in where we stand right now. All right, and I want to just mention that one of our contracts with Virginia Tech Polo is they're bringing in a clinic, and with that clinic comes this gentleman named Tony Azevedo. He's the five-time Olympian and silver medalist for water polo. So he'll be in our facility the beginning of March, and that's pretty neat. They went out and they've already got their hotel blocks and figured out their schedules. That's the first time that we've seen water polo come to the Aquatic Center. Okay, and I want to just have a few more things, and then I'll finish up some hot news for you that I wasn't able to put in the PowerPoint. for the last couple of years, it's been really important for me to try to feed our summer camp kids. You know, I know there's programs out there that provide lunches for these kids, and I wanted that at our aquatic center. I thought there was a need in our community. And so Olivia has been working hard. We weren't successful last year, but we just had a verbal commitment from Feeding America to provide lunches and one snack for all of our summer participants at our camp. Very pleased with that.
If you
take the USDA calculations, that's about over a $15,000 monetary value. And because we're able to get the Feeding America behind us, we can now apply for a grant from the National Parks and Recreation Association, which is a $25,000 grant. So our fingers are crossed, and Olivia is working hard on that we'll be able to follow through with that program. I wanted to also add that you may have noticed that the sign at the end of Mill Lane is a little not looking real fresh. Has anyone noticed that? It needs a little work. You'll probably, now that I pointed it out, you'll definitely notice. So I called, and they're going to submit a quote to see how much it costs to kind of get that pieced up. And you can see we took out all the bushes, and we're going to put all the flowers in there, so into that area. I wanted to just leave you with letting you know that we do have a challenge at the Aquatic Center, and it's obtaining lifeguards. Recruiting lifeguards and obtaining them. I'm not sure, you know, I've been in the field over 30 years, and this isn't anything new. It's not new. It's a hard job. You know, our lifeguard is a first responder. And, you know, they now weigh with the fact of, you know, do I do this job, or do I now do a job that maybe is a $12 or $15 an hour job, without the liability of being a first responder and responsible for saving someone. So you'll see a lot of full-time staff working lifeguarding, which is fine once in a while, but it keeps us from actually growing our facility and moving forward when all the full-time staff is lifeguarding. So any word of mouth that you can help and would truly be appreciative. We'll be holding, I hope, a spring job fair with our HR department. We also go into the high schools, set up during lunch, those types of things, and let people know that we have the summer jobs and the opportunity for lifeguarding. We offer free lifeguarding training. All you have to do is turn around and give us 240 hours. So we've really reached out and tried to get that going for everyone. And if you hear of anyone looking for a job, we'd be more than happy.
Yeah, that's what I was getting ready to say.
Yeah. You hear that?
You guys should be really paying attention to this and putting that feedback in there.
That's very good. That's pretty much all I have for you this evening. Do we have any questions?
Yes, ma'am. Who you contacted for a job?
Just walk into the Aquatic Center, and it's always online on the town's website. So just go into christiansburg.org and go into employment opportunities, and you'll see the Aquatic Center job opportunities are right with that, all the other jobs in the town.
And do you train lifeguards as well?
Train them, yep, we'll train them. And we have classes that will be held this spring.
Terry, you guys in the RU Career Center, I don't know if they deal with, you know, I think their mission is postgraduate, but do you guys have a presence at Radford University, since there is a relationship now between?
I go to the job fairs that are set up outside.
Okay.
And then I believe HR also sends those job postings to the universities. Am I correct, Randy? Yeah. So the communication's getting out. It just needs something. And, you know, we're at the same wage that we were when we opened the Aquatic Center.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, that's sometimes something to think about, too. You know,
hey, Terry, if somebody rents the Aquatic Center after it closes, what does that include? Include lifeguards? And
yes.
Oh, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yep.
Okay.
And it's for up to 100 people, 250. And if you go up, well, then obviously the price goes up, depending on how many people.
Okay, yeah. One other question. The second grade program, I think, is wonderful. I think there shouldn't be a kid in town who can't swim. Have we looked at talking to any other clubs around town to try to help with the rest of the grades? And how much approximately would it cost for a club to get involved to sponsor this?
We haven't looked at that. When you say clubs, what exactly are you referring
Civic
to?
Or?
Yeah, anything that, you know, you know, the lines, Kiwanis, you know, whatever.
Oh, I see. Okay. Yeah. Sure. No, we can definitely reach out for them to them and
okay.
see.
Yeah.
You know, I've always been told by our Kiwanis that if I have someone reach out to me that can't afford swim lessons,
uh-huh.
that just to call them and they would be more than willing to support that.
Okay,
so I do know yeah. that I have that at
okay,
least in the back
too.
Pocket.
Okay. Approximately, what would it cost to sponsor a grade?
A grade?
Yes. Like a second grade you got going now.
Mm-hmm.
If you want to sponsor the fourth grade.
I think
grade.
The entire program for the second grade is about $5,000.
Okay.
Yeah, I think.
Okay, thanks.
You're welcome. One thing I wanted to just add too is that when we talk about retaining the swim meets in town and bringing them back, one thing that's really important is keeping up with the technology. You know, that timing system and that competitive pool is huge. You know, that's a major piece for what a new facility could come on and bring. They could potentially bring, you know, to starting blocks. Our starting blocks are 7.5, 8 years old. They've already designed a couple different starting blocks since then. So, you know, those type of things, we have to stay on top of all of those things in order to get these swim meets to come back.
And I'm glad, Terry, that you mentioned that. That's something we need to always look at, especially at the aquatic center. I know that, I mean, I started swimming there once a week, which I've said many accounts of, but that was my wife and I, my goal last year. But they are starting to look actually older than that. And that's something we're going to have to remember. And I'm sure, Terry, you led into that because my question to Randy from his weekly report to us about these new facilities opening and what's our plan, and I appreciate you touching on that. But that's one thing we have to remember as council, that you know, we got to continue to upgrade the facilities at the aquatic center. The one thing, both my kids swam, and of course I'm down there anyway once a week, but one of the things I see all the time, what I hear from at least timers and things like that, what's up with all these wires that are on top of, you know, for the, so that's something, you know, that I would hope that the advisory board that you're taking to them, and that you can report back to us, because you really embraced council years ago. We wanted participation, and what that means, we want people either local or in the region coming to the aquatic center. And we gave Terry, it wasn't a carte blanche, so to speak, but we did encourage it. And she had, you know, if you see some of the things up here, these are all sort of new still that we're getting people in the facility. And I want to challenge you and your staff and the advisory board to keep looking at that and keep reporting back to us and be real when it comes to it. You know, you hear every year about during the budget season, oh, we can't do this, and oh, we got to pinch a penny here, and we should. That's what we. But if we want the success of this center, which is one of our major operations, which brings people into our area, which then is a ripple effect, why you see all these brand new hotels coming up around Christiansburg. I think 4 in the past 2 years.
Yeah.
I mean, and that brings additional revenue into our town. You know, we're going to have to really think about what we can do to help them out to replace those items.
Our Colorado timing system, Colorado has already informed us that they've come up with something all new.
Yeah.
And they'll feed into our program for a couple of years, and it's in the capital improvement, but after that,
yeah.
you know, you have to get on board with the whole new system or...
If we don't maintain our competitive edge in this, then Liberty and Lewisburg is going to trump us. And then councils years from now are going to be pointing the finger at either Terry or the director or administration saying, why are we getting trumped? Why aren't we having as much as we have right now? So we have to remember to invest wisely, but do it right.
Do you need council's approval to adjust part-time pay for lifeguards? You hinted at something. I don't know if you were careful choosing your words carefully, but is that something that you need council's approval for, or is it mainly just a part of your budget? Can you adjust?
It was a budget request last year as a lump sum that I was hoping to be able to allow the part-time employees that are rising to the top to give them a quarter raise or a 50-cent
right,
raise,
right.
those types of things, because right now, at the aquatic center, if you come in as a lifeguard at $8.75, you have to work there 3 years before you get a quarter.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, that's just not working.
Well, you said it's the same since we've opened the center. So that right there is a problem.
Right, yeah. And you need to eliminate hurdles.
So it's something to look at. I didn't put anything in this year's budget. I felt that it wasn't the right time, but it needs to be the right time soon.
Well, I think Brad and I are on the finance committee. I would like to see a proposal with that. And because I hear parents all the time, I wish they would get a job. And we're all like, well, you have a job right here. Well, there's jobs all over town, folks. It's just whether or not the child is willing to do it or the parents willing to push them to do this. Being a lifeguard is a great responsibility. Teaches at least our young adults some great responsibilities, which any job can. But, we have to eliminate hurdles. And if we can pay a little bit extra to get those additional students in there, so be it. That's eliminating a hurdle. Why wouldn't you want to work here? You're going to be paid great money.
And you take even the summer pool, when the summer pools come on board,
Yeah. They're
paying $10, $12 an hour.
Right.
So even if you are working at the Aquatic Center, you're leaving the Aquatic Center and you're going to the outdoor pool.
Right.
And, the unfortunate thing, I think, is that we're tied into the 25 hours per week. Before that, it gave these young professionals an opportunity to earn some money. But right now, they can only work up to 25 hours per week. So those 25 hours are really important to them. Where are they going to do it at? Are they going to do it at the Aquatic Center for this wage, or are they going to do it down the street for another wage? So I think it's just all kinds of things in the mix that I feel that we probably need to look at.
Yeah, Blacksburg Transit's having the same problem type of thing.
Yeah.
And it's that part-time. They pay, well, yeah, and they do the training, but I'm glad. Great presentation. I need to move on, but that's something, I think
we'll tackle that.
Thank you so much.
Thanks, Terry.
Thank you, Terry.
So, Meredith.
Thanks, girls.
You're going to take this up, everything we mentioned tonight, right?
Yes.
All right.
Thank you.
I'm going to follow up.
Other committee reports. Any committee met to report? Okay, hearing the committee reports, we have amended the agenda to consider the request from Don Hiller on the property located at 840 Pepper's Ferry Road. I understand it was unanimous through the Planning Commission to do this?
Yes, it was.
Yes. I make a motion that we grant these. Rezoning, I guess it's just the rezoning of the property owned by Donald and Rachel Wood as presented in the Planning Commission recommendation.
I second it.
Got a motion and a second. Any discussion? Madam Clerk?
Yes, sir. Councilman Bishop?
Aye.
Councilman Collins?
Aye.
Councilman Hubbard?
Aye.
Councilman Showalter?
Aye.
Councilman Stipes?
Aye.
That's 5-0 and 1 absent. Mr. Elboy, your request is passed, and we will go through the rezoning. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, guys.
Yes, sir.
Staff reports, interim town manager.
Councilman Bishop is currently serving on the Montgomery Tourism Development Council, and he is up for reappointment. And just going to let you know, I am going to basically nominate him for reappointment to that board. I'm one of the voting members on the board, just passing that along.
And can I say something too? I'm one of the reliefs on that board, and I'm not able to do that now that I'm working.
Would you want to appoint a second alternate?
Yeah.
A different alternate?
Please, yeah.
To tourism?
Yes.
Anybody doesn't work during the day when they do?
I guess you're looking at me.
How's the participation? Is it better?
Better than
me. I just know when I was on, let's be realistic, I was on that board, I remember showing up, I was the only person.
Oh, no.
It's not like that now.
Okay.
I'm more in favor of being
a backup if Steve doesn't want to, as long as there's other people there besides me and Lisa and her assistant.
And I'll be glad to be on.
Okay. Steve, you got it.
I'll nominate Sam and Steve as well.
Thank you.
Just to let you know, a couple of letters of support that I've been requested to sign, and these would be commitments for next fiscal year. $4,000 for a New Valley housing study that the PDC would conduct with the Virginia Center for Housing Research and Housing Virginia. Basically, these are ideas that came through the regional commission and our monthly managers' meetings. And I think, you know, $4,000 to fund a housing study for the whole New Valley is small enough money that I feel like we can commit that with your blessing.
What are you going to take for $4,000?
It would be a report on housing affordability, housing availability, housing stock, age of housing, things like that.
Is it this through the regional commission?
Yes, it is.
All right, this is the one we heard about the patio homes or senior living. Mm-hmm. That's going to be part
yes,
of it.
Yes, it would.
Yeah, that was a big concern with a lot of communities in the region, Bradford. Mm-hmm. Not everybody can be as lucky as you, Mr. Stipes. Any private joke, sorry.
And also, I've been asked to commit $7,000 to funding of a small business development center position to be housed out of New Valley, out of the Red Oak office to serve the New Valley.
Absolutely.
I know I've mentioned that to you before, but just if I could have your blessing to go ahead and commit to that.
Do you need nods or?
I think that's sufficient.
Yeah, I think it's good.
Okay. Yep. And I just want to bring up the noise ordinance. Of course, we had the court case continue, or I guess from last week continued, basically for 90 days. And during the, I guess, hearing, the Teresa had said that we were considering amendments to our ordinance. Basically, there was agreement between both parties that it be continued for 90 days pending our review of the noise ordinance. Teresa, Andrew, Chief Sisson, and I have met about this, and we think we have a workable solution. We would take that to the Planning Commission, and we would also solicit other general input into that. And I guess anything you'd like to add?
What we've done is we've taken our noise ordinance and just made some amendments to it to make it a lot simpler. And that noise ordinance, Andrew will be setting up some meetings where the public can have some participation in that. In our current ordinance, there's a waiver provision that we're going to eliminate. We had considered doing a noise permit as part of the noise ordinance, but after discussion, we're thinking that it probably should be part of the permitting of any kind of noises, or especially loudspeakers or loud amplification equipment in a zoning district should probably be under the zoning code as a conditional use permit. So we've got a couple different things. So currently our noise ordinance, the way it's currently structured, subject to input from the community, is going to be much simpler for our law enforcement personnel to enforce. And then any use that will be an outdoor use that'll be loud, if it's not a singular event or a random event, if it's going to be something that's more, you know, ongoing and permanent, will be under the zoning as a conditional use permit in the business districts, and that's basically the business districts. And ag, I think by law there's certain things we can't regulate, like under the breweries and wineries. That's a different situation. But so I know it sounds complicated, and we've taken a lot of time and energy to try to see if we can just sort this out. It will be a civil matter from now on. There'll be fines versus possible incarceration, which is a lower standard. It's not, you know, the burden will not be beyond a reasonable doubt, which is a heavy burden when you have exceptions in a zoning ordinance. So
when it's all worked out, it'll come through council, and you'll sort of brief us on what you've done.
Yes, yes.
It'll go through our planning commission, too.
And of course, it's a code amendment. It would have to come
it's
back.
All, yeah, it's a code amendment. It'll go.
Right.
Before it goes to the planning commission, are we going to have some planning commission? I mean, instead of bringing it right straight to them, we have to work sessions.
Yes.
Yes.
To talk about it. Okay.
So you'll have, there'll be many opportunities for community.
Yeah.
Input.
And we'll make sure they get advertised in the paper, and we'll give a copy of the working draft to the press, okay, so that it's out there and get people to participate.
I'd have bet money we didn't get a signed ordinance that most everyone supported, and by golly we did. So maybe we'll have the same success with this. I mean, Hill, Mr. Johnson's here, so it's up. Carry the torch, Hill.
No pressure.
Harry, yeah.
Okay. That's all I got. Trish, you got anything else?
Nope.
Any other staff present, Val?
We'd like to set a public hearing for fees for the recycling, curbside recycling. We'd like to have that at the second meeting in March.
Okay.
I guess one other thing, too. Of course, at our work session this afternoon, we did not get to the recognition of arts and buildings downtown property owners. If we'd like to have that as a future work session. Also, coming up
next...
Who's
presenting that?
That would just be staff.
Can we tack it on to one of our...
We can. The next council meeting, we have the Small Business Development Center coming. That's at 5:30 on the 27th. Also, let you know that Jim Wynn got back to me on a potential meeting date for his training for FOIA conflict of interest training. And he would like to do that March 27th, second meeting in March, if he could.
That's prior to the meeting, to the work session, or during the meeting?
It could be either a work session prior to the meeting, or it could be tacked on as a work session after the meeting, either one.
Okay. That would sound reasonable. Do you want to just thank you?
What would your preference be?
Five-thirty is fine to me.
Prior to?
How long does it need to take? Half hour?
Guess
can
probably,
you do it in half an hour?
Probably, maybe a little long. I think I'd allow an hour.
Yeah.
Give it four. Good. What date is that?
The 27th.
That's six. Council meeting. Six. We have got work sessions stacked. I'm personally
going to
do my best.
I'll mention planning commission interviews. Of course, you've got the town manager.
You've got our budget starting.
Yes, budget.
So the answer is yes, but if it's an hour, then I say six at the earliest.
Six on the 27th.
Would you want to put discussion of arts recognition?
How long do you think that would take?
I figure maybe a half hour.
Would you mind going at 5:30 just so we can...
Yeah, I'll do it. Is this on the 27th?
Yeah.
So both
of
those...
Start off with that.
5:30 on the 27th. So right now you've got three work sessions. Small Business Development Council on the 27th at 5:30. You've got the town manager search this Thursday at 5:30. And on the 27th at 5:30, you've got the FOIA and Conflict of Interest Training and also the Arts and Building Downtown Recognitions. Mm-hmm.
You bring it all ham biscuits?
Okay. All right. Anything else?
If it's anything else you'd like to set, like I said,
you've got to start doing some of these things at 5:30 in the morning.
And we do need to get several of the committees together in the next few weeks. Street committee and central business committee, if it could, in the next couple of weeks. And sometime before the end of the month, also, we want to do finance committee.
Is it the 20, let me make sure I'm getting my dates correct, the 22nd, maybe, that the DCI is having a meeting that is kind of a top of the town.
That's next Thursday.
22nd, 6:30.
Yeah, but I mean, I know that I've suggested that our central business committee members attend, and anybody else, you're going to do it down at Ignite.
Mm-hmm.
So that's a good thing. All right, council reports. Mr. Huppert?
I'd like to thank Terry for bringing up that. That was very nice of you. And I think everybody knows that I am into cancer research, and if you are afraid that you cannot make it that day, and if you want to just give me a check to the American Cancer Society, I would be glad to accept that. If you want to come, that would be great too. And I also want to bring up this Friday and Saturday, at the down there at the Great Great Wall, that they're going to have a big art show that starts at 1 o'clock, and it goes on the whole afternoon and go through the whole area and look at art. And then Scott Crawford will be there that night at 7 o'clock, and he does an art presentation. I've seen the guy before. He does a nice job. And then the next night is a music, and I think I passed that around before. And that's a good way to support the town, if you guys can make it. Thanks a lot.
Mr. Stein?
I had a brief report. I told Mr. David Clark that I would recognize his efforts this evening. David, Mr. Clark is the VDOT resident engineer for this area, and as we all know, he's a backdoor friend with us, and he goes to bat for us on a lot of things. About a week and a half ago, I contacted him with some citizens here and people watching. You may have noticed the tremendous delays that are experienced at the intersection of North Franklin Street and Pepper's Ferry Road, 114. That intersection has got out of sync. The video detection system and so forth is not operating. It didn't appear to be operating correctly. Now I live out 114, I noticed these things. But that, I contacted David about a week and a half ago to ask who do we need to contact as a town. He said I will look into that. So a couple days ago, VDOT was out there with bucket trucks, and they got a thing. The actual term for it is called snappy. It's actually very snappy now. Mm-hmm. So our police will probably appreciate that. But that particular intersection, I don't know if you've sat out there yourself, but it's been very slow. There's been a lot of green time where there's no cars using the intersection. And you will notice that it is now snappy, and we can thank David Clark for that. And that's a technical term too, so it's you won't be waiting like you used to. So thanks to David, and if you see him, thank him for that kind of responsive assistance.
Mr. Showalter,
just from the regional commission that Mr. Collins and I and Mr. Johnson sit on, the last meeting they introduced a lot of the new members that are there, and it's always. It's amazing. I've been on it for a little over 10 years, and Mr. Sipes, you served on it prior to, and you were even chair at one time. But, you know, the amount of participation that our neighbors, town of Pulaski, county of Pulaski, Floyd, Nares, Giles, just the participation level now that I see show up, and it's just incredible. You know, we're all sort of working under one goal, but just some of the FYIs, and I'm not sure if Harry can. Some of the notes I took down, but just for council wise, that Radford may leave as an entitlement community for the CDBG funds due to the ever reduction of funds from our state. And then one of the things that they were talking about, some of the services, and of course being the regional commission, they can part, you know, not only are we a partner in there with our other neighbors, but one of the things I found very interesting, because they went through every department this year, what each one does. But I thought the economic envisioning, which we're doing so much, especially with the Roanoke firm for the economic development, which for small businesses. But I thought this was interesting. I was wondering, and I know, Randy, you got a full plate. You're doing the job of two people right now. But even if you need my help, I mean, to reach out, because they do offer for a municipality to do an economic visioning. And you bring in people from your local businesses, and the economic or the regional commission actually runs it, but you get your stakeholders in, and you find out what your priorities are as a town when it comes to economic. And I think that would be good for us to put on, hopefully this year, but not in the next few months, of course, but probably towards the end of the last quarter, to bring some stakeholders in and have the regional commission along with us participate and do some economic visioning to see what's going on out there, what we can do better, or but I think that would be something very positive. That's it for me.
Okay. I'd like you to follow up on that. Continue.
I will.
Remember.
Very good.
Mr. Bishop?
I don't have anything.
Mr. Collins?
Yes, sir. With what Henry said, they also talked about stuff that they could help us with, and we asked them to help us with a study on the transportation when we get the Amtrak service in here. You know, so they agreed to do something on that as well.
Also, the planning commission, the openings have closed, and we have three applications, and usually we interview, you know, all of them, and I guess we need to set those too, you know, to interview these people.
Sounds like a good work session.
No.
No mess. So we want to let the planning commission run those interviews and recommendations to us?
They never have, but we can.
I mean, we've interviewed some we have, and
I would like to continue what, I know it's an extra work, but I mean, that's what we're mandated to do, and these are, I'd rather be part of that selection process for the planning commission. I know that knocks out about an hour and a half, but we've always been part of it, and I'd rather us choose it than the commission choosing it.
Okay,
that's our mandate.
Oh, yeah, that's fine with me, too. That's what we've all
I want to speak for council. I mean, that's an extra day, but I'm willing to do that.
Henry's got a good point. I mean, we really count on the planning commission for what they even know is tonight. It's come out several times. We'll have the planning commission look at this. And so we want people that we can count on. So I agree with Henry on that.
We've always done that.
Okay.
You got a date?
Set a date.
It can open Tuesday.
Or Thursday.
Next Thursday.
If that's okay, everybody,
yeah. Got a talk of the town with DCI next Thursday.
What time is that?
6:30.
6:30 today.
How long does that last?
How many people you have interviewed?
Three
though.
You do have an off Tuesday, next Tuesday, with no work session. The 20th.
I'm good with that.
Yeah.
What's that with you?
Start at 5:30.
5:30.
Okay.
All right.
Okay, so who's going to contact?
Keep us posted on this, Randy, because I've
got him. Okay.
I didn't bring my phone, so I don't ever catch up with all this stuff.
What was that date again?
I'm sorry.
March 20th.
At what time?
5:30.
All right.
Okay.
Very good. Thank you. I don't have anything. Most all of them's been touched. Mr. Hubbard touched on the Hearts on Main, which is an excellent program. I recommend anybody that has a chance to go to one or both of those. again, to mention Megan, she gave a lot to the town. So, anyway, those are my issues, my concerns tonight. Any other business to come before council?
I have a request for a closed meeting in accordance with Code of Virginia, subsection 2.23711(3) for the discussion and consideration of the acquisition of real property for a public purpose or of the disposition of publicly held real property where discussion in an open meeting would adversely affect the bargaining position or negotiating strategy of the public body. The closed meeting pertains to discussions regarding a potential public works property in Montgomery County.
Got a motion? Got a second?
I second it.
Any discussion? Madam Clerk, call the roll, please.
Yes, sir. Councilman Bishop?
Aye.
Councilman Collins?
Aye.
Councilman Hupper?
Aye.
Councilman Showalter?
Aye.
Councilman Stipes?
Aye.
It's 5:01. Thank you very much. We're going to go into, we're going to take about a 3-minute recess and we'll return back to second to reconvene. Madam Clerk?
Councilman Bishop?
Aye.
Councilman Collins?
Aye.
Councilman Hupper?
Aye.
Councilman Showalter?
Aye.
Councilman Stipes?
Aye.
I move to certify that the town council of the town of Christiansburg meeting in closed meeting, to the best of each member's knowledge, discussed only public business matters lawfully exempted from open meeting requirements by Virginia law, and only such matters as are identified in the resolution to enter into closed meeting.
Got a motion?
Second.
Motion and a second. Madam Clerk?
Yes, sir. Councilman Bishop?
Aye.
Councilman Collins?
Aye.
Councilman Hupper?
Aye.
Councilman Showalter?
Aye.
Councilman Stipes?
Aye.
That is 5:01, and council is not taking any action on that matter. Anything else to come before the town council?
No.
We are adjourned.